You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome to the third installment of Criminal Justice Administration 446, Understanding Terrorism. My name is Gus Martin, and we're being broadcast from the campus of California State University, Dominguez Hills. Tonight, we're going to study the beginnings, the causes of terrorism. We're going to have a number of very interesting examples and case studies, as well as videos. What I would like you to do, though, is please phone in if you have any questions at the toll-free number 800-339-1193, or please send a question via email at askdhtvlive@gmail.com. All questions are welcome and all will be discussed. We will have the interesting videos and good case studies, good examples, but first I'd like to begin by simply saying that tonight, you will need a great deal of organization when we talk about the causes of terrorism. There are a few lists and categories that one needs to know. And in order to begin this conversation, we come back to the question of extremism. Understanding the fertile ground that causes terrorism, we have to understand the roots of extremism. Extremism grows out of movements and dramatic events. So let's take a look at these, movements and dramatic events. Firstly, let's define what a movement is. Now, what is a movement? Well, it is activism for change. Change to preserve something or change to attempt to overthrow the existing order. It is mass action. It is not simply one's opinion or acting out on one's individual beliefs. So my personal interaction, my personal acting out on my individual beliefs is not a movement. It requires masses of people. Examples of movements in the United States that are moralistic include the civil rights movement, the Christian fundamentalist movement, and these are moralist in the sense that they both are similar in their overall goals. They both sought the moral high ground. We will come back in great detail to movements in the United States when we discuss extremism and terrorism in the United States specifically. We'll spend an entire evening discussing this. So just keep that in mind for now, and we will come back to it. Secondly, dramatic events. Extremism grows out of dramatic events, and a better way to view this might be traumatic events. Extremist behavior is a reaction to some sort of trauma. The trauma can be to an individual, to a national group, to an entire people. The point is that these traumatic events cause a reaction. For example, I'll give you examples of each of these. An individual's trauma. Imagine if you are sitting at the dinner table when you're a teenager or a child, and men break in, and they assassinate your father before you at the dinner table. That's traumatizing. And that child may grow up to join the cause that his father had been a member of. That sort of thing happens every day in the world. Unfortunately, individuals become extremists or even terrorists based on events like this. So children of the victims of death squads would be a good example of an individual's trauma. Secondly, national trauma. In other words, a nation's trauma. Let's look at Afghanistan for a moment. The Soviet invasion of Afghanistan led to or precipitated the events that we are still living with. The Mujahideen, the holy warriors who fought their jihad, their holy war against what they perceived to be godless communist invaders, came from all over the Muslim world, and they eventually defeated the Soviets, killed 15,000 of them before the Soviets withdrew, and the rest is history. The Mujahideen did not give up their struggle. We will discuss this in greater detail when we discuss religious terrorism during this course. There's also a people's trauma, a national group's trauma, an ethnic group's trauma. A good example of this would be the Kurds. But for an unfortunate turn of history, there would be a sovereign nation known as Kurdistan. However, the Kurdish people have been divided between four nations: Iran, Syria, Iraq, and Turkey. They have been fighting for their independence for more than a generation against the Turks, against the Iraqi Arabs, against Syrian Arabs, and against Iranians. In northern Iraq, they have their first chance at autonomy since our invasion and overthrow of Saddam Hussein, and they're taking their chance. They're well-armed, well-trained, and well-motivated. But that's a people's trauma. Let me give you two case studies that you should keep in mind: Black September and Bloody Sunday. If you understand these case studies, you will understand how what we might call a terrorist movement might begin. But from their perspective, it is a freedom fighters movement. Where you stand depends on where you sit. So firstly, let's look at Black September, 1970 in Jordan. Black September occurred when the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine attempted five hijackings. Now understand, hijackings were not common at the time, but the Palestinian people, in their minds, had been ignored by the world community. It was considered to be an internal problem to the Middle East and to Israel. So the PFLP attempted five hijackings, three of which succeeded. Leila Khaled is perhaps the most famous hijacker from Black September. We will come back to Leila Khaled later tonight. We will talk about her. The three airliners were flown to Dawson's Field in Jordan with 255 hostages aboard. When this occurred, the world took notice, suddenly. The hostages were released by the Popular Front for Liberation of Palestine, and the hijackers then blew up the planes. Now understand that these days, Black September would be considered to be almost humane. These days, the hostages would have been killed inside the planes. The morality of terrorism has changed. A terrorist group or movement, eventually known as Black September, continued the fight internationally throughout Europe and the Middle East. The Jordanian army attacked members of the Palestine Liberation Organization when this occurred because they were not happy with the fact that these airliners had been hijacked and then destroyed in Jordan. There was major fighting between the PLO and the Jordanian army, and the PLO was expelled from Jordan. That was when they moved primarily to Lebanon and elsewhere, and that is where the International Palestinian Liberation Movement began. The war began to be fought on the world stage by what the recipients of this violence called Palestinian terrorists, but they refer to themselves as freedom fighters. So that is the beginning of a long history that is not ended yet. Another example, from January 30th, 1972, Bloody Sunday. The troubles in Northern Ireland can be essentially dated from this event, this traumatic event. One question I like to ask many of my students is, why did the American civil rights movement succeed? The answer is that There were allies in government, in the Supreme Court, politicians, and even the presidents supported the American civil rights movement. In Northern Ireland, the Irish Catholics, many of them attempted to replicate the American civil rights movement, holding peaceful demonstrations, singing, "We Shall Overcome." Well, on January 30th, 1972, Irish Catholic demonstrators, clashed with the authorities. British paratroopers from the 1st Parachute Regiment opened fire on the demonstration. 10,000 demonstrators were present, and 13 people were killed, and many others were wounded. At that moment, history could have been very different, but what happened was, because of this shooting, many Irish Catholics believed that they had no allies in the United Kingdom or in the world. The Irish Republican Army literally had to turn people away from its recruiting stations. There was an uprising among Irish Catholics, and the rest is history. The troubles began very violently. What I would like to do right now is break to a short video so that you understand Bloody Sunday, why it occurred, and why it was the precipitating event for the Troubles in Northern Ireland.
In the Northern Ireland city of Londonderry, a Catholic civil rights march is underway. Tension in the area between Catholics, Protestants, and the British Army, specifically members of the Parachute Regiment, had been growing for weeks. Civil rights protest was turning into a riot as more and more Catholic youths began to shower the security forces with stones, petrol bombs, and other missiles. The troops opened fire, the crowd scattered. When the shooting stopped, the casualties were counted. 13 Catholics dead, another 17 wounded. As the shock of it all began to take hold, it wasn't long before that sad day became known as Bloody Sunday, another date in the Irish calendar of tragedy, another setback on the road to any prospect of peace.
This event is an excellent counterpoint or counterstudy to what could have happened, perhaps, if in the American Civil Rights Movement, rather than the protesters being beaten at the Pettus Bridge on our Bloody Sunday, if they had been shot, gunned down, and the authorities, if they did not respond favorably, what would have happened if African Americans had no allies in the United States, in the federal government? Now, let's look at explanations of terrorism. Let us look at extreme circumstances. We're going to become a bit theoretical. We're going to look at sociology, psychology, and revolution as strategic choice at the moment. It's a bit theoretical, but these are different explanatory categories which will help us to understand why people become terrorists. And there's been a great deal of research among sociologists, psychologists, political scientists about these various categories. I'm just going to give you a flavor for them this evening. First of all, the fruits of injustice. Sociological explanations of terrorism. And the root concept here is whether terrorism, what we might call terrorism, actually comes from injustice. Is it the fruit of injustice? First of all, understand these two concepts as causes. Within the category of deprivation, absolute deprivation, relative deprivation. Absolute deprivation refers to when a group of people, are absolutely deprived. They may be hungry. There may be disease. They may have no protection from government. They are struggling to survive. The theory is that people who are absolutely deprived may have no choice but to pick up the gun and the bomb and resist. And most of us can understand that. If you have a comment about that kind of concept, please let me know. Please call in at the toll-free number or send us and email, and I'll answer your questions. So absolute deprivation is a theoretical construct in which those who have nothing to lose may rise up. But there's another kind of deprivation, and that is relative deprivation. This is something that we live with every day in the West and in the United States and here where we're broadcasting from in the Los Angeles area. Relative deprivation refers to when individuals live in a society, they see the wealth around them, but they are relatively deprived. They may be poor in an affluent society. They do have enough to eat, but understand that poverty means that resources may not be there. If someone becomes ill, let's say the breadwinner becomes sick, then the paycheck will not come in. If the car breaks down, you cannot get to work, won't be paid. And yet they see people living in Beverly Hills, they see people in the world who are doing very, very well for themselves, and they're wondering why they cannot achieve these things. Relative deprivation as an explanatory model means that those who live in an affluent democracy, perhaps, may rise up because they see no other avenue to achieve success or achieve what others have. And we see this in developing world countries, in cities like Sao Paulo and elsewhere, where relative deprivation can lead to political violence or extremist behavior. The bottom line for the sociological phenomenon or explanation is that terrorism is a group phenomenon. It's a product of intergroup conflict, and it is a strategy of the weaker group. The disadvantaged group asserts their rights, and this can often be based on perceptions. The perception may be that there is an opportunity for change among the disadvantaged group. The perception may be that the government is weak or the government is corrupt and brutal. And the perception may be that the people are ripe for revolt, ripe for revolution. There are a number of examples of this throughout history with this kind of sociological explanation that we can point to. For example, when you talk about movements being motivated against a social system, we can look at Spain, northern Spain, among the Basque people. The Basques were relatively deprived. They had their own national and cultural identity. They had a perception of Spanish exploitation, which was accurate. It was real for generations. There was Spanish cultural domination among the Basque people in the north. And there was a very violent history stemming from the Spanish Civil War, in which the Basques opposed the fascists, but the fascists won the war. So there was a Basque separatist organization that engaged in terrorist activity known as ETA. ETA fought for a generation against Spanish dominance. ETA was violent. They engaged in assassinations, bombings, bank robberies, and other kinds of sabotage. ETA had some popularity among the Basque people, and it wasn't until the Spaniards responded and actually granted semi-autonomy to the Basque region that ETA began to lose its support among the people. Having said that, ETA still exists. They still are fighting that war. Another example is the Irish Republican Army. They view the British dominance in the north, in Northern Ireland, as an occupation. And in fact, the British have engaged or did engage in authoritarian tactics to try to suppress the Irish Republican Army. They engaged in authoritarian tactics through arrest without charging people. Due process rights were compromised. Things were occurring. And there was a perception of essentially a colonial Protestant domination in Northern Ireland. And there is the example of the Palestine Liberation Organization, and now Hamas in the Palestinian territories. They view Israel as being a Zionist occupation nation, occupying nation. The Palestine Liberation Organization is interesting because they are a secular organization or secular movement. Hamas is not. Hamas is Islamist. Now, having said that, though, Palestinian nationalism is a good example of a movement motivated against a social order. We are going to take a break and look at another video from the Battle of Algiers. The thing to think about is, when you look at this video, understand that in the Battle of Algiers, there were a lot of precipitating causes for the revolution, the revolt, the civil war, if you will, the anti-colonial war that occurred in Algeria. The National Liberation Front in Algeria did engage in terrorism as a tactic, and they will admit that. But if you look at this video, you'll see how the precipitating events led to that behavior. And as we see this, I would like you to think about what this means, what the meaning of this is, and please phone in or send in your message, your query through email. So let's take a break now to look at the Battle of Algiers video, the first portion of it.
Malgré la pression des milieux colonialistes les plus intransigeants, il paraît que le gouvernement ait donné des ordres sévères de n'utiliser les armes qu'en dernière extrémité. Mais au cours de cet après-midi, ont eu lieu les premières tentatives de descente dans les quartiers européens. Et il y a eu de nombreux morts. Maintenant, le calme semble revenu. Mais on continue à entendre des quartiers musulmans ces cris incompréhensibles, scandés, effrayants.
Surprenante unanimité de ces démonstrations a influencé de larges couches de l'opinion publique française. Selon des nouvelles de Paris, la partie la plus sensible des milieux politiques serait orientée vers la recherche de nouveaux rapports avec l'Algérie.
As you can see from this excellent semi-documentary of the Battle of Algiers, this is how a popular uprising can begin. A popular revolt can begin, and those who are participating in the revolt might resort to what we would call terrorist violence. This is how it begins. We will continue to use the example of the Battle of Algiers and the Algerian case study as we move into another explanation, rationality in terrorist violence, psychological explanations of terrorism. As we become psychologists and look at the psychological perspective, keep those images in mind and understand the psychological dynamics of what we are moving into. And if you have any questions, if you have any comments about the dynamics, these precipitating events, please call in at the 800 number or send us an email and we will answer your questions or comment with or engage your comments. Now, psychological explanations. We're going to look at several psychological explanations. These are very broad approaches. Remember, this is just a flavor. This is just a sampling of psychological explanations. And they can overlap with each other. So the first psychological approach is terrorism as rational choice among alternatives. Key word there, key phrase is rational choice. Many of us, perhaps most of us, think of terrorists as being crazy, being insane, being psychopathic or unbalanced or unstable. Well, some are, without question. However, most are rational, and they actually engage in selecting from a menu of options, and they select political violence. So this is a rational choice among alternatives. There was a psychiatric study that was done of the Red Army faction terrorists in Germany. They found, for the most part, they were of higher intelligence. They were educated, middle class, intellectuals, but they were violent. They were terrorists. So think of the struggle as having a menu of options, violent options and less violent options. Among the violent alternatives would be payback. In other words, acts of vengeance. This can be perceived as a last resort and can grow out of frustration and impatience. Then there are less violent alternatives, which are generally rejected. This could be include just taking the abuse by the group or attempting to negotiate a solution, perhaps, or trying to reform the system. These less violent alternatives are rejected by the more extreme members of certain movements. Another psychological explanation would be terror as a way to maintain group cohesion or movement focus. In other words, violence is a rallying point. Violence is used to promote group solidarity so that the group solidarity overcomes individualism. And there is research into looking at how does one suppress individualism within a movement. Well, violence is one way. This brings together a people or fellow believers. They rally around this particular kind of violence. Sometimes within this particular explanation, the individuals can be made up of diehards in a struggle, the ones who are simply refusing to surrender or refusing to admit that they might be able to be defeated, rejecting anything other than victory. So they may be refusing to recognize a truce or an agreement. They were refusing to surrender. They might constitute a fringe of a fringe and could actually be a last gasp. It is often a last gasp in a particularly political movement. Examples of this would be some of the factions, the splinter groups from the Irish Republican Army, groups like the Continuity Irish Republican Army, the Real Irish Republican Army. Some of these groups are still active. They're still around, still available. Or in the United States, our homegrown terrorist groups on the left during the 1980s were splinters from the movement that occurred in the 60s and 70s. Groups like the May 19th Communist Organization, which we will discuss when we come back to the United States. Now, Another psychological explanation, a third one, is very interesting. It refers to terror as esteem building. Now, this is where we get into a very interesting proposition, very interesting theory that was proposed by a psychiatrist named Frantz Fanon. Frantz Fanon was a psychiatrist from the Caribbean island of Martinique, which was then a French colony, French possession. He moved to Algeria and became the chief propagandist for the Algerian resistance. So, let's explore this. It's a very important concept, and it's very influential for politically violent people. It is used by many to justify violence to this day. Frantz Fanon was onto something. My personal opinion, he was very accurate in what he was theorizing. I would like to ask you, what do I mean by esteem building from a political point of view, from an extremist point of view? And please let me know if you agree, disagree, or have comments on this. Feel free to dial in at the 800 number or send an email to me and we can discuss this. Under Frantz Fanon's theory, this is a way for the poorest of the poor to establish power over others. The weak become strong. The attention that is derived from engaging in what we might call terrorist violence or political violence, this attention itself becomes self-gratifying. And remember, he's a psychiatrist who's proposing this as a way to explain or justify political violence. In fact, he was justifying political violence. The outrageous speeches, or what we consider to be outrageous speeches or outrageous behavior, is a victory in and of itself. Even though the perpetrator may die or the uprising or the demonstration may fail, it is a victory in and of itself. Frantz Fanon wrote a book called The Wretched of the Earth, which is still being read, still being published. You can get a copy of it. It's a very influential book in the developing world. We in the West kind of read it intellectually, or perhaps if it's assigned in a political science class, but it is still influential. He wrote this in the early 1960s. When he went to Algeria and became the chief propagandist for the National Liberation Front, his book became very widely known among rebels, among revolutionaries. At that time, Algeria was a part of metropolitan France. It was considered to be a part of France in the same way that Puerto Rico is considered to be part of the United States, or the U.S. Virgin Islands are considered to be part of the United States, or American Samoa. These are the possessions of the United States. Well, at that time, Algeria was considered to be a possession, a part of metropolitan France. There were about 1 million French colonists living in Algeria, living very well in comparison to Algerians, native Algerians, and they had established a culture, in French culture in Algeria. What Frantz Fanon said was, one who is oppressed must find oneself through violent revolution. He referred to living within a particular culture as living with mind-forged manacles. In other words, chains that are in your mind. So one must liberate oneself. One must break those chains through violent revolution. He wrote the following, which is very profound from an extremist point of view. He wrote, "Violence is a cleansing force, freeing the colonized from their inferiority complex and from despair and inaction. It makes them fearless and restores self-respect." Frantz Fanon called this cleansing force, this violent cleansing force, liberating violence. This concept of liberating violence. Terror, in his worldview, terror and atrocities are needed to throw off the chains of oppression. Now, the philosophy students amongst us, philosophers, those of us who have read philosophy, might recognize this as being a branch of existentialism, which was a French philosophical movement and tradition in the post-World War II era. Existentialism was very influential. Frantz Fanon's approach to liberating violence is a form of existentialism. So I'd like to know, what do you think about liberating violence? How do you think it helps to explain atrocities? How do you think it helps clarify one's code of living or code of self-sacrifice? Does it purge one of your mind-forged manacles? Is it a cleansing force like a fire? I want you to think about these questions of liberating violence as we look at a second and final installment of the Battle of Algiers, because what you will see in these concluding moments of this semi-documentary is the results, the outcome of liberating violence depicted. So let's go to see the video.
Écoutez-moi. Retournez chez vous. Qu'est-ce que vous voulez?
L'Istiklal! Rouhou bladna! L'Istiklal! L'Istiklal! Al-Haqq hurriyatna!
Avec l'indépendance, naquit la nation algérienne.
So you see, the question becomes, from Frantz Fanon's perspective, what happens when the people become fearless in the face of guns, tanks, and other kinds of methods of repression? What happens when they become fearless? Can they be defeated? From Frantz Fanon's perspective, no, they cannot. Another psychological explanation of what we might call terrorist violence is this idea that terrorists are action seekers, not philosophers. They're not trying to prove a point, an intellectual or debating point, not trying to win debating points. They seek action. They seek to carry out the revolution, to make revolution. They train, they fight, and perhaps they die. They are wholly committed, totally committed to the revolution, to make revolution. They consider themselves to be an elite that will lead the masses of people, the movement, to liberation. Members of violent extremist groups always consider themselves to be an elite. They are the action seekers. The concept to understand here is this concept of a vanguard. The Marxists had a concept called vanguard of the proletariat, which is very applicable here, in which when you talk about this idea of the tip of the spear, well, this is a psychological explanation. They are action seekers. This philosophy is applied for a future utopia. They may not see this utopia in this life, but they will make revolution for the next generation. We see this repeatedly throughout history. We are seeing it now with the Mujahideen, with ISIS, with the Taliban, with others who are preparing the revolution in their minds for the future generation. Within this mentality, the vanguard considers themselves to be oppressed, but superior. The enraged masses are superior morally to the corrupt system. So belief is fine, it's okay, but action is superior. And this takes us to a fifth explanation of the psychological explanation of terrorism. And this is simply the justification of violence, the psychological justification of violence. We have already said, last class, that the target is depersonalized. Violence becomes a cleansing act, as Frantz Fanon said. So a terrorist or a violent extremist might attack a building, bomb it, destroy it perhaps, but there are people inside. So for example, a business executive representing corporate interests simply becomes an objectified target so that the enemy is dehumanized. The psychological justification of violence means that any human who is perceived to be the enemy is dehumanized, and they are perceived to be a justifiable target, symbolic target. This is very important to always remember and to remember throughout this semester. Labeling is used. Extremists will hang the labels on their perceived enemy, and humans will become nothing more than a capitalist, perhaps, or an imperialist, or a Zionist, or a colonialist, and the list goes on and on. It's a very long list. The point is this label is hung upon human beings, and it is used to justify violence by dehumanizing them. So symbolic violence is okay. Symbolic violence is at the root of, the core of terrorist violence. This concept of armed propaganda is one that we must always keep in mind. It is a form of propaganda, and when the target is dehumanized and objectified, the attack itself becomes good propaganda. Now, let me just, to finish up this concept of psychological explanations, let me just give you an interesting case study that is used sometimes to explain why people join movements. This case study took place in Stockholm in August of 1973. It is known as the Stockholm Syndrome. It is when someone is taken hostage and they are surrounded and actually have no ability, they are helpless, no ability to help themselves. The question is, why do some of them actually begin to favor their captor? In Stockholm in August of 1973, there were two bank robbers who took four hostages during the bank robbery. The bank robbery went sour. They became besieged in the bank, and there was a six-day hostage crisis. During this hostage crisis, the bank robbers engaged in perceived acts of kindness. They told, for example, told their hostages they would be shot in the leg rather than killed. They should play dead if the authorities come in. One individual had claustrophobia, but she was let out of the vault in a rope, with a rope leash. All of the hostages began to sympathize with the robbers. They became loyal to the robbers for months afterwards, when the crisis ended. They all denounced the authorities. They refused to testify against them. They raised money in their defense. One woman became engaged to one of the robbers. The question is why? I would like you to think about why someone might actually begin to sympathize with their captor, begin and perhaps join them. This happens It's a fact that it happens, although this idea of the Stockholm syndrome is perhaps controversial, but it does happen. So please call in if you have a comment or question, or send a message via email if you would like to comment or you have a question on this. Now, let us move on to another explanation category. Again, we're still in the realm of theory. There's a great deal of research in this, and this would be the criminological explanations of terrorism. This is the path to political violence. Understand that this is highly theoretical, but there are some studies that show that there is viability to these theories. The first one that I'd like to point out is one known as differential association theory. Differential association. Highly theoretical. What it says is this is a process of social learning. Crime is a process of social learning, and extremist violence, extremism, is a process of social learning. Both criminals and law-abiding people and extremists and non-extremist people learn their behavior from associations with other people. For example, people will imitate and internalize these associations. They strive for similar goals, but choose different paths. So the goals might be identical, such as wealth, such as power, such as freedom, such as liberation, but the path to get there is different from others. Another example of criminological approaches are referred to as anomie and strain theories. These can be complex, they can be highly theoretical, but the idea is, the general idea, bottom line idea, is that there is a focus on the availability of goals and means. Once again, we all may want similar goals, but acceptable means may differ. Perhaps the poor do not have the means to achieve those goals in the same manner that I do, or some others may have. Perhaps the poor might have to choose, for example, other means that we might consider to be unacceptable, but it may be perceived as being the only way to achieve the same goals. If one lives in desperate circumstances, who is to say what is acceptable and what is unacceptable to achieve freedom? We can all understand this. And then within criminological theories is this idea of routine activity theory. This is a convergence, if you will, of three societal elements. First one is a steady supply of motivated offenders, meaning within our context, a steady supply of motivated extremists. People are motivated to engage in extremist violence or motivated to join an extremist movement. Then their second convergence is a ready availability of attractive victims and targets of opportunity. It means there's no shortage of representatives, these symbolic representatives of targets that can be attacked or demonized or denounced. And the third convergence is the presence or lack thereof of social guardians. In other words, these people are on their own. They do not have anyone who's looking out for them at all. Now, which brings us to, remembering what I've said about these highly theoretical criminological approaches, this brings us to radical criminology, which seeks to explain criminal behavior and has been used to explain extremist behavior based on society's inequitable ideological, political, and sociological makeup. Fairly simplistic, if you will, that crime and extremist behavior comes from inequality. Now, yes, it does. That is a fact. However, the question is whether that is the primary precipitating quality. So if there is a dominant ideology, a dominant political system or party, or socioeconomic oppression or inequality that is not going to change, the radical criminologist will say This is where extremist behavior comes from and crime comes from. Within this vein, let us take a look at why people in the West, in the United States in particular, in this particular video we're about to see, why they seek to join modern-day extremist movements like ISIS or ISIL. Because as you know, there are thousands of Westerners who are joining ISIS or ISIL. So within the context that we've just been discussing, think about this video and why these individuals join ISIS or ISIL. Let's break to the video now.
It is just as chilling as the voice.
My name is Abu Oneda. I'm from America.
An American proudly joining the fight in Syria. To stop them before it's too late, today the U.S. Attorney General launched a new fight.
We have established processes for detecting American extremists who attempt to join terror groups abroad.
In a video message, Eric Holder announced pilot programs to encourage more people to come forward if they suspect someone is becoming radicalized. The idea is that community leaders, law enforcement, and religious leaders will work together in cities across the country to spot potential recruits.
We can work with them to identify threats before they emerge, to disrupt homegrown terrorists, and to apprehend would-be violent extremists.
More and more countries are worried their citizens have joined ISIL and could return to launch attacks at home. Already, a suspected French ISIL fighter is accused of killing four at Brussels Jewish Museum earlier this year. And over the weekend, in both Germany and Indonesia, possible ISIL suspects made news with court appearances and arrests. The U.S. government believes at least 100 Americans have joined the fight in Syria, including Munir Muhammad Abu Saleh, a 22-year-old from Florida, and Douglas McCain, 33, from San Diego. Both have died, but many others are still fighting, and tracking them can be incredibly difficult, especially once they slip into Syria.
My brothers living in the West, I know how you feel.
Which is why the U.S. is now focusing on stopping them before they leave.
Several things to take from that video. One is that the precipitating events are these concepts of deprivation, some of these strain theories and radical criminology that we've talked about may be leading to why people are joining these groups. And you notice how the United States would like, essentially, communities to go to the authorities to tell on, to actually rat out, if you will, to inform upon individuals who they think might be becoming radicalized. Well, okay, they may be perceived from their own point of view as being targeted by the authorities or society. Be interested to hear your comments on this. Please feel free to call in at the 800 number, or please send an email in with your question or comment. Now, let us investigate revolution as rational choice, moving beyond our sociological, psychological, and criminological approaches. So revolution as rational choice. Think in terms of an act of political will. Political will. In other words, one is trying to force change. That terrorism is simply a tool that is used to achieve something. It is a rational tool. It's a choice to promote the revolution. All one needs is the will to achieve it, no matter what the cost. Political will, trying to force the revolution to happen. I'll give you an example. Let's take a look at Marxism for a moment. It's an excellent case study, which we will study again later in the semester. Karl Marx, the founder of Marxism, said that capitalism is rotten and will inevitably be destroyed, that history is a scientific law, not will, that capitalism will collapse after spontaneous revolution essentially. Well, Lenin, who led, of course, the Bolshevik Revolution, essentially said capitalism is not as rotten as we would like, so we need to give it a push. The will of the people can make history. This concept of the vanguard of the people, the vanguard of the proletariat, began with the Communist Party, the Bolshevik Party, in Russia. Keep this in mind throughout the rest of our discussions through the semester, because this idea of giving the revolution a push is one that we see again and again, and we still see it. We will come back to this concept again and again. Now, Mao Zedong, who led the Chinese Revolution, the Chinese Communist Revolution, linked his military strategy to his political strategy. There was no differentiation, no separation between this act of political will, this act of the vanguard of the people, and his military strategy. This idea of political will that he promoted had a conceptual root in rural guerrilla warfare. This idea of people's war that Mao Zedong promoted, the people were at revolution, engaged in revolution. The people rose up. The party and the people and the struggle and the revolution were linked together. There is no separation, no differentiation. We see this continuing in the world too. So this idea of people's war is truly a concept of political will. Three basic and very simplistic principles are involved in Mao Zedong's concept of people's war that we still see. ISIS is using it. First of all, indoctrinate the troops. Make sure they understand and know why they're fighting. Secondly, win over the people. Get the people behind you. And lastly, hit, run, and fight forever. Never give up. Hitting and running are critical. We might consider it to be retreat, but they don't. They hit and run as a strategy and fight forever. The United States and the West tends to think in terms of fighting for 5 or 10 years. Well, the other side might think about fighting for generations. It is a different mentality. Very often under this concept of people's will, there will be intentional disruptions of government-sponsored programs and events or successes that the enemy might have. There are bombings and et cetera and other violence that are used to destroy infrastructure. So you need to ask yourselves why good things are destroyed. The answer is that one will taint anything the enemy does, even what they do successfully. One thing that we should keep in mind always is that when good things the enemy does are destroyed, it shows how weak they are. It shows that they cannot govern. When 9/11 happened, they showed that we are essentially weak. They attempted to show. That's the symbolic value, that we are essentially weak. When these attacks, these spectacular attacks happen, the other side thinks that we will not respond, or that if we do, it doesn't matter. The attack in and of itself is a victory. So let us look at adversaries in the war on terrorism. Understand the 9/11 case. We're talking about lighting the fuse in the modern war on terrorism, and the attacks on September 11th, 2001 did light the fuse. The reasons that the other side has proposed for why they attacked on 9/11 is that they wanted to show the world that they could strike the West in its heartland. And understand that there have been, during the war on terrorism, this idea of the modern day war on terrorism, there's this idea that some of the things we do are actually causing more people to join the cause. So we mentioned the war in Afghanistan from when the Soviets invaded, the Russians invaded, and how the Mujahideen swarmed out after the war and continued the fight into the modern era. Well, there was a report in 2004 that was issued by the Central Intelligence Agency in the United States, declassified, in which they said that the Iraq invasion, our invasion of Iraq after the September 11th attacks, would create a new training ground similar to what happened with when the Russians invaded Afghanistan. And it seems that they were correct. There is a new generation that has arisen, that is being inspired by the resistance to the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, the modern wars, the American-led wars, and the wars in Syria. Very similar to the aftermath of the Soviet war in Afghanistan. I would like to show you a short video that explains this, which shows how Al-Qaeda and ISIS have similar genesis, similar origins. Al-Qaeda grew out of or grew from the resistance to the Soviets in Afghanistan. ISIS grew from resistance to the American-led coalition in Iraq. Very interesting perspective. So let's go to the video.
ISIS and Al-Qaeda have deep ties and a long history. In fact, when ISIS began during the fight against U.S. forces in Iraq, it was allied with Al-Qaeda and shared a name. It was called Al-Qaeda in Iraq. And there are other similarities and connections as well. Both these groups sprung from long civil wars. Al-Qaeda, the fight against Russian troops in Afghanistan. ISIS, the fight against American troops in Iraq and later against Bashar al-Assad in Syria. Both groups seeking to establish an Islamic state, a so-called caliphate. Also, both of them willing to establish that state to attack and use brutal violence against both non-Muslims, Americans, Westerners, and Muslims as well, non-Sunni Muslims, but really any Muslim that they consider not devout enough, not extreme enough. But there are many differences, and it's some of these differences that greatly concern U.S. and other Western officials. ISIS has been able to seize and control much more territory than Al-Qaeda was ever capable of. Today, ISIS controls broad swaths of both Iraq and Syria. Two, U.S. officials tell me consistently that ISIS behaves, it seizes and controls territory very much like a military force, not just a terrorist organization. They're much more difficult to fight. Three, ISIS is largely self-funding. It operates as a government in the territory that it controls, issuing taxes. It also uses extortion and theft to get money, and it even sells oil in areas that it has captured in Iraq and Syria. And by some estimates, it's making $1 million a day or more. Finally, although there were some Westerners who joined Al-Qaeda, Anwar al-Awlaki among them, ISIS has proven a much more powerful magnet for Westerners and Americans. It's now believed, U.S. intelligence officials say, that something along the lines of a dozen Americans have joined ISIS and dozens more have joined other extremist groups in Syria. And the great concern is, what happens when those Americans, when those Europeans come home? Do they bring jihad with them?
So as you can see, there are similar origins for both Al-Qaeda and ISIS. And the one worrisome element with ISIS now is that they're inspiring Westerners, including Americans, to join them. And the fear is that this is a genuine tactic, that it is well thought out, that they will return home. So we are going to take a short break right now, and we will come back and discuss the morality of political violence as a way to understand the causes. So we'll take a short intermission right now, and we'll come back and we'll talk again after the break.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, I'm Bruce Betts, Director of Projects for the Planetary Society, and I'm here at Planetary Society headquarters in Pasadena, California, talking to you about the Young Scholars Program and my introduction to planetary science and astronomy class at California State University, Dominguez Hills. One of the main things Planetary Society does is educate and inspire the public about space and space exploration.
So science education is the key to our future, not just California. Not just the United States, but the world. And I'm not kidding, because we have enormous problems to solve around the world. And to understand them and to solve them, we're going to need scientists and engineers. And this is what the Planetary Society does, is get people excited about science through space. We try to advance space science and exploration, really, for the betterment of all humankind. And it all adds up. So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
I've been a guest at the Cal State Dominguez Hills distance learning classes and been able to talk about my research on Venus and Mars, but also on all of the really cool research that's being done on planets all over the solar system by the active missions that are out there right now. I think that it's really fun to be able to share the adventure of exploring the solar system with audience, with all different kinds of people coming from all different places, whether they're adults or kids, current students, or people who were last students a long time ago.
In the case of this class, to be able to actually not only reach out to new audiences, but provide detail information and really share what is an inherently visual type of science, planetary science, with TV.
At Cal State Dominguez Hills, like at any university, our primary mission is to educate students. Through the Young Scholars Program, we at CSUDH are partnering with the Planetary Society to get high school students from around the state of California interested in science and careers in science even before they enter college. In so doing, we stay involved with our local community and make opportunities available to these students that they might not otherwise get.
So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
Tune in to DHTV on Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era.
Hello, my name is Leroy Harding. I'm a junior at California State University Dominguez Hills. The reason why I chose this university was for small classes and interactive programs.
Hello, my name is Dave Bader, Director of Education at the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach, California. I'm really excited to be a partner with Cal State Dominguez Hills and DHTV. It gives us an opportunity to reach audiences that are much broader than the audiences that we can reach by visitation just here at the Aquarium of the Pacific.
My name is Kira Mathis. I'm an education specialist at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and I teach here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills the Biology 190 Introduction to Marine Life course. I love teaching this class. We get to partner with the college and come over, and this is really important because we get to bring a dynamic to this course that the aquarium is great at offering. We get to show animals from our local coast, talk to experts, and reach students that maybe have never even been to the ocean before.
Join the Aquarium of the Pacific and learn about marine life. DHTV makes it all possible.
Teatro Dominguez is a multicultural theater company here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. And the program is designed to do play readings, workshops, and folktale tours to local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is that we are not doing theater so much as a entertainment, doing theater to help make our lives better. It is community service first and theater second. So for instance, Teatro would do a play reading of a play about assimilating into American culture if you're an Asian immigrant. And that may be performed in a middle school or here on campus. I've had a number of teachers ask Teatro Dominguez to come into their classrooms to read scenes. We have workshops where we would bring a group like Culture Clash in or Cornerstone Theater Company to help our students learn about community-based theater creation. And the touring show is always interesting. Every year we take a folktale or we create a folktale of our own, which is animals talking in masks, and we tour it to local second grade classrooms. So what Teatro does are is really educational theater. It is theater that focuses on social issues, and it has more of a direct purpose for society.
Good. I think they rose to the occasion.
Dude, love, love. Brother, love, that Mandarin sauce is ridiculous. The heat was fantastic. I enjoyed the flavors.
Our champion is the Literals.
Hello, my name is Maria Rosales. I'm a senior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm majoring in Criminal Justice Administration. The reason why I decided to come to this campus was for its great faculty, great location, and friendly environment.
On this job, safety is our first concern. There's a lot that can go wrong. But fortunately, we have Cal State Dominguez Hills, the only authorized OSHA training center in the Los Angeles area. If you're in need of OSHA certification, or if safety is one of your concerns, call 888-4LA-OSHA and learn how to be safe. Remember, safety comes first. Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in the humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to Understanding Terrorism. My name is Gus Martin. I'm a professor here at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I encourage you to phone in if you have any questions to our toll-free number, and also send any other questions to our email address, and we will discuss, or I will accept your comments, and we'll proceed. I'd like to move into the morality of political violence. Just a discussion of when we talk about the causes of terrorism, certainly there's a moral component to what is going on. So what I'd like to do is look at this not only from the point of view of society, but also from the point of view of extremists and terrorists. So firstly, let's take a look at one perspective, and that is the moral perspective of terrorists. In other words, moral clarity. Most terrorists and extremists are very clear about the justice of what they are doing. They're very clear about the purity of what they're doing. There are different ways that one can come to this conclusion. One might be that a person or group believes that they have been morally wronged. They believe that powerful and evil forces are arrayed against them. They feel betrayed. They feel exploited. And this can have some legitimacy, frankly. If there is a history of repression, the outcome might be excessive resentment against the established order. And this is a morally clear conclusion. Another way that they might achieve moral clarity is when a group believes that it is morally superior, just naturally superior to the enemy group, but simply because of the way they might have been born, or maybe that their cause is more holy than the enemy's. So this is good versus evil plus morality. Within this perspective of moral superiority, no compromise is possible. The outcome is extreme self-righteousness. A second sort of moral motivation are simplified definitions of good and evil. In other words, we are right, they are wrong, period. There are no gray areas. There's no discussion points with this. And there are different ways that one can come to this conclusion. Individuals might be indoctrinated by society to believe this. And whether you accept it or not, we are all indoctrinated as we are raised. Or an individual may come to believe this. They may come to believe that there are simplified definitions of good and evil. As we conceive with the Westerners who are now joining the Islamist groups in the world, they come to believe this. They were not necessarily indoctrinated or raised to believe it, but they come to believe in simplified definitions of good and evil. Another moralistic motivation is this concept of seeking utopia, either a utopian future or a utopian past, one or the other. And you need to ask yourself, what is utopia? In fact, I would be interested to hear your thoughts on whether this is pure fantasy or whether, from the perspective of an extremist, this makes a lot of sense. So please phone in or send in an email and we can discuss this. Utopia. Examples of this are that from the left-wing extremists, they believe in a utopian future. So leftists generally believe that the old order is ancient, it must be destroyed, it is decadent, must be destroyed, and they will move forward to a utopian future. Extremists on the right wing are kind of interesting because just broadly and generally speaking, roughly speaking, they believe in returning to some sort of utopian past which they have lost. This concept that someone has stolen their superiority, their superior condition, or some other thing, and that we must now destroy that group that has actually taken away our superiority or essentially our utopia. Within this perspective, or these rough perspectives, the promised good outweighs the present actions, no matter how vicious those actions might be. The revolution will bring utopia so that the end justifies the means. The end justifies the means. Is that a legitimate concept? One can debate this, one can discuss it. One must understand, though, that some people truly believe that the end justifies the means. This is particularly popular among religious and ideological extremists. Religious and ideological extremists do believe that the end will justify the means. Let us go to a short video that demonstrates, that exemplifies this these concepts we've been talking about moral motivations. Well, there seem to be some technological difficulties with that one. Our apology for that. Let us move on to a final concept within this overall heading of motivations based on morality. And this is a very important one. It refers to codes of self-sacrifice. Actually, I've just been prompted that the video is ready. Let us go to the video.
We need to do more to stop people traveling. to stop those who do go from returning.
ISIS now boasts militants from 74 countries around the world among its many thousands of recruits.
My highest priority is the security of the American people.
How governments are dealing with their citizens turned jihadis and taking steps to keep them from coming home, now on the New York Times Minute.
What is like your everyday regular Canadian? I watched hockey.
Much of ISIS's recent success can be attributed to its unrivaled international recruitment drive. Foreign-born fighters provide manpower as well as immense propaganda value.
We have not yet detected specific plotting against our homeland.
But the fear is that some ISIS fighters may return home and commit acts of terror. Counterterrorism experts say that has been rare in the past, but nonetheless, world leaders are changing laws to limit any possible returns.
The ambition to create an extremist caliphate in the heart of Iraq and Syria is a threat to our own security here in the UK.
Russia has made joining ISIS a criminal offense. Saudi Arabia has done the same. Meanwhile, the United Kingdom is weighing how to revoke a Britain citizenship altogether. And later this month at the UN, the United States will propose a binding resolution to compel member states to help prevent and suppress the flow of jihadis. But recent history offers an example of the challenges of protecting against returning jihadis. Moner Mohammed Abu Salah was a Florida man who joined the Nusra Front, an ISIS rival. He traveled to Syria for extremist training without being noticed by U.S. authorities. He then was able to buy a return ticket to the U.S. Eventually, he went back to Syria and killed himself in a suicide bombing there. As the UN debates the issue and more countries institute measures, governments will have to balance their security concerns with the desire not to alienate their own Muslim citizens. For example, if France cracks down, it could have a ricochet effect and create even more jihadis.
Let us now move on to the concept of codes of self-sacrifice. The videos we've been watching are from what is occurring now in the world. Understand that the individuals who are fighting for these organizations that we are observing now live according to a code. That code of self-sacrifice is, at the moment, one that is mostly religious. It's the code of the Mujahideen. But there are other codes, too. So let us take a look at this, and I'll give you examples from the modern era of these codes of self-sacrifice. This is a very important concept to understand. It's almost a universal human concept. The codes of self-sacrifice are believed to be a superior code of living. Those who follow the code are superior to those who do not. The code accepts a certain truth, a specific truth, and applies it to everyday life. In the modern era, this has usually been a religious or an ideological or an ethnic truth. And one commits themselves to this truth and sacrifices themselves, or is willing to sacrifice themselves for this truth. Recent codes of self-sacrifice include a couple of them that occurred during the Second World War, which I will use to illustrate how this sort of code can create an entire nation of believers. It's excellent for understanding modern extremism because it is certainly still a very viable force in motivating people to do what they do. And these modern codes of self-sacrifice are ones that I'm sure that you have heard of. So let's look at two of them from the Second World War. The first one refers to, it comes from Germany, and it refers to the German Waffen-SS. Remember that during the Second World War, the Nazis believed that they were racially superior to other groups. The war in the East against the Russians was a racial war. The Waffen-SS was an organization which accepted so-called Aryan supermen, purebred Germans. They were trying to create a master race and trying to have that master race dominate Europe and possibly the world. This was a return to what they considered to be a primal or primeval utopian past. The SS members were Nazis. They were more or less an imperial guard of the party. They were racially selected. They were indoctrinated in their superiority to be racially dominant in Europe and in the world. One branch of the SS was used as shock troops. They received the best weapons and provisions and training throughout the war, and they were fairly effective soldiers. They were absolutely ruthless against those who they fought against, shooting prisoners, massacring individuals who from enemy populations, and then perhaps marching away singing marching songs. They engaged in a racial crusade in Russia. The actual intent was, believe it or not, was to enslave the Slavs or push them beyond the Ural Mountains and colonize Russia and the East with Aryan farmers. Heinrich Himmler, the leader of the Reichsfuhrer of the SS, said the following: "You have seen the bodies by the hundreds and yet remained decent fellows." The idea is that because they are members of this racial elite, they could slaughter people by the millions and sleep well at night. Concentration camp officers might kill hundreds during the day, then go home to their families at night, literally relaxing around the pool with their families, with their children, and then killing hundreds of more the next day. All one had to do was follow the code, and the code would cleanse them. The Nazis killed 26 million Russians during the war. This was intentional. A second code of self-sacrifice, or code of living, occurred in Japan. The Japanese militarists lived according to what they called the code of Bushido. The warrior's way is what Bushido means. It was a warrior's code of service. It was a return to the way of the samurai. And it was embodied or symbolized by the cult of the sword. You literally had fighter pilots going into their planes with swords attached to them, antique swords. They believed in obedience, devotion, and discipline. Under the code of Bushido, Japanese soldiers had absolute contempt for defeat or surrender. This is why Japanese soldiers would ritually kill themselves if they were faced with defeat or surrender, or engaged in a last, what they called victory charge, a bonsai charge, in which they would charge into certain death against machine guns, hand-to-hand combat, knowing they would die, but it was honorable to them. So they had utter contempt for defeated populations, for allied soldiers that surrendered to them. In Germany, about 1 in 20 allied prisoners of war died because of conditions. In Japan, 1 in 3 American POW prisoners of war died. The Japanese killed 13.6 million Chinese during their war against China. Understand that these two relatively modern codes of self-sacrifice are excellent exemplars of what we are still experiencing in the world. We might wonder how these beheadings can occur, these crucifixions that ISIL is committing, the enslavement of women, the mass rapes, things like that. Well, this is why. Because they live according to, in the modern era, the religious code. If you have any comments about these codes, please call in or send an email to our email address. I would like to show you a video which is very interesting, that it's very short. It explores the duality and mission of ISIS on social media and how they present their code. So understand that these beheadings and other atrocities that they are committing are being sent out through social networking media, posted on YouTube, posted on Facebook, and we can all access them. So let's break to the video.
The Islamic State has entered our consciousness for multiple reasons, partly for the savagery they're willing to commit, and also because of the savvy they display in spreading their message. For some analysis yesterday, I spoke with Shadi Hamid of the Brookings Institution and author of Temptations of Power, Islamists and Illiberal Democracy in a New Middle East, and Philip Smythe, a researcher at the University of Maryland and blogger at Hezbollah Cavalcade, who studies Islamic extremism. So Shadi Hamid, compare
these guys to Al-Qaeda. It seems that we were almost better off getting these grainy videotapes from Osama bin Laden out of a cave compared to what we're seeing today.
So ISIS are quite advanced in their marketing and media strategy. They've been very active on Twitter. And for those of us on the outside trying to follow them, you can actually engage with some of these people on Twitter, and they're actively tweeting about somewhat mundane things. There was actually a Twitter meme where ISIS fighters were eating out jars of Nutella. But on the other hand, you also see very savage things like beheading. So there's a kind of strange duality, a schizophrenia, that they're showing this dark, brutal side, but they're also trying to show, at least as they might see it, a more humane side to Western audiences. And those, you know, we're not going to buy that as Americans, but for people who are potentially sympathetic or fence sitters, seeing those images can actually be appealing.
So, Philip Smyth, it seemed that in the past it was guys holding machine guns in the backdrop of a video. Well, this is how tough I am. Seems now the bar is I have to be holding a human head in an Instagram.
We've seen stuff like this before. It's not really that new. I mean, it's just the platforms that are being utilized. Twitter, Instagram, you mentioned, Facebook. There's now direct outreach to the people they wish to recruit and the people they wish to influence.
And so why is this escalation? I mean, is it an escalation of the savagery? Do these groups feel like there's no other alternative? Or why go to these extremes now?
Well, one thing that ISIS wants to do is instill terror in the hearts of their opponents. So when say, the Iraqi army or the Syrian army see images of beheading and mass executions, they think to themselves, if they get caught by ISIS fighters, that's what will happen to them. So that really hurts the morale of anyone who's trying to fight ISIS. And we saw that in a very striking fashion with the Iraqi army. ISIS was going into Mosul with a much smaller number of fighters, but the Iraqi army just essentially dissolved. And that's part of it is because they were hearing all these stories about the military prowess and the savagery of the ISIS fighters. So it does really have an impact on the battlefield.
So Philip Smyth, he mentioned earlier kind of almost the hijacking of conversations. They're not trying to hijack aircraft. They're trying to get into the consciousness of people who are talking about anything from Nutella to the Ice Bucket Challenge.
Correct. They want to have a full sweep. If you're trying to cast any kind of a narrative, you want to look as sometimes average as possible. If somebody's trying to recruit me, they're going to want to interact with me like they were a friend, like how we're talking now. It's probably one of the best ways to get in and influence somebody's mind.
So some of this is coming into or across our radars because these people understand English. We've had this larger conversation of Westerners becoming radicalized, but it's also because they know the difference of what the West is talking about.
So there's an important distinction here. The head of the Islamic State, Baghdadi, it's not as if he himself is tweeting or any of the senior figures around him. We're talking about the younger fighters on the ground, many of whom are English-speaking and many of whom are European, even a few that are American. So for them, they grew up with Twitter, they grew up with Instagram, and Twitter is about something you just do during the day. So they go on the battlefield, there's been a big fight, their instinct is to tweet about that.
How the influence of kind of American speakers, or I should say English speakers, throughout the Western world participating in this conversation, how important is that to the recruitment of others?
Well, it's extremely important. If one of your target audiences, if their sole language is English, then it's necessary to bring them in as foreign fighters. But it's not simply that. As an analyst, I also have interacted with IS supporters, and they will try to influence material that comes out of other analysts. So they understand this is kind of a full spectrum approach, if you will, to spread their narrative or to influence other people that are on the web.
So are you finding, say, for example, the State Department now is kind of engaged in trying to battle this conversation with kind of hashtags of their own, trying to find, is that successful at all?
So, yeah, the State Department actually has a Twitter account focused on countering some of these jihadis and extremists online, and specifically on Twitter. It's hard to say how effective that is. Perhaps it's better than doing nothing, but we shouldn't kind of delude ourselves into thinking that public diplomacy can really change people's minds in a very obvious way. The American government doesn't have a lot of credibility with anyone who's going to be vaguely sympathetic to the aims of the Islamic State. So it's not just a problem of message, but also the messenger.
Does the U.S. government have not just any street credibility, but have any chance at trying to intercept that messaging that the Islamic State seems to be pretty successful with?
Well, in terms of monitoring recruitment, we do spend billions of dollars a year on the NSA, which I would assume monitors quite a bit of this traffic. But in terms of kind of countering the propaganda, it's always good to have what's called trolls. You know, IS people do have their own trolls that will harass American government accounts and other analysts' accounts. And sometimes it's good for a little pushback just to show that the United States is watching and that occasionally it can also poke at them.
All right, Phillips, my Shadi Hamid, thanks so much for your time.
What we see here is a very modern 21st century way to spread the code, these codes of self-sacrifice. You do it through Twitter. You do it through Instagram. And there's not a whole lot we can do about it. We cannot really counter that kind of social networking media. When we see these images of, for example, a seven-year-old child holding a head with his father standing next to him, we are horrified. And yes, it could affect our morale. But from the point of view of this code, it is a recruiting tool. Their ruthlessness is a recruiting tool. And that's why we see so many foreign fighters joining groups like ISIS or ISIL. Now, tonight we have investigated the causes of terrorism. We've looked at criminological, sociological, psychological explanations of the causes of terrorism. We've looked at philosophy, morality, several different viewpoints when we talk about causes of terrorism. What I would like to do is conclude with two case studies. The first case study will be of Carlos the Jackal. The second will be of Leila Khaled. We will begin with the case study of Carlos, because he's very interesting. He's an absolutely fascinating study in how someone can adopt a revolutionary ideology that's not his own, but he becomes very active within a movement. Arguably similar to how Westerners are becoming active in the Islamist movement in the modern era, Carlos became active in the international nationalist and ideological movement of his era, in his time. So, let us talk about an individual named Ilich Ramirez Sanchez. He is a Venezuelan. His father and grandfather were communists, and he had two brothers. One brother was named Vladimir, another brother was named Lenin. So he was named Ilich, Vladimir Ilich Lenin. His parents were dedicated communists. He attended a university which was then in Moscow, the Patrice Lumumba People's Friendship University, which was a university in which the Soviets set up to bring in young people from all over the world to essentially become indoctrinated in communist ideology. While Ilich was there, Ilich Ramirez Sanchez was in Patrice Lumumba People's Friendship University, he met Palestinians. And Palestinian nationalists at that time were seeking a way to become better known on the world stage, for their cause to be better known. He linked up with the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine. He traveled to Beirut, Lebanon, and joined the PFLP. At that time, you could walk into an office, essentially, of the PFLP and join them. He adopted the name, the nom de guerre, of Carlos. He thought that it sounded like Khalil, you know, the Arabic name. And Carlos became notorious in the world. Carlos was personally responsible, probably, for 83 killings. Now, of course, when someone does this out of a sort of a psychopathic motivation, we call them a serial killer. So Carlos could be considered to be perhaps an ideological serial killer. He engaged in bombings, shootings, assassinations, and he is one of those bigger than life, larger than life personalities on the world stage. He, for example, in 1975, when the members of the oil petroleum exporting countries, OPEC, were meeting in Vienna. In 1975, understand that OPEC was the most powerful organization in the world. These individuals had the ability to turn off the oil spigot if they wanted to. He burst in with German comrades and kidnapped them, held them hostage, and essentially would not let them go until the cameras were there, until the media appeared. And when he boarded an airliner, he and his comrades boarded an airliner to leave. They received a handsome ransom. They were being videotaped, and they flew off into the sunset at that time. Carlos was dramatic in his escapes. He once leaped from a balcony down below, or from a window anyway, and leaped down below, where a vehicle was waiting for him, and he sped off into the sunset. He eventually went to Sudan and was found in Sudan and wound up being rendered, if you will. We would now call this an extraordinary rendition, in which he went in for surgery, and he was rendered by the French, placed aboard a French military plane, flown to France, where he went on trial for the murder of two gendarmes, that is sort of military-like police, and he spent the rest of his life in prison, in a French prison. He's still there. This is a good example of an international terrorist motivated by international ideology. Please phone in if you have any questions about this as we wrap up, or if you have any questions through email. Now, let us talk about another individual who represents a different kind of terrorist. And in fact, the debate is whether she is a terrorist. And we'll get to that in a moment. Her name is Leila Khalil, who was very famous at the time as being the symbol of Palestinian nationalism on the world stage. And she also has one of these larger-than-life profiles. Leila Khaled was a Palestinian woman who was born in Palestine, what was then Palestine. When she was 4 years old, her family was expelled from Palestine. And they went to Lebanon as part of the refugee outflow, if you will, or emigration of many Palestinians at the time. We have to always remember that about 400,000 Palestinians left the new state of Israel after the War of Independence for Israel. And those 400,000 Palestinians moved into refugee camps around the Middle East, you know, in Jordan and in Lebanon and elsewhere. And the conditions were harsh, and they existed for at least a generation. So these are the conditions that caused Leila Khaled to become what they viewed as being a freedom fighter, what many of in the West view as being a terrorist. She has said that she was conscious of politics at a very young age. And she has said that at the age of 15, she became a revolutionary. So she is a lifelong revolutionary. At the age of 23, she hijacked her first airliner. And when she hijacked her airliner, she forced it to fly over her home city in Palestine, symbolically. This was an act of, if you will, of defiance, perhaps revenge, but the point is very dramatic. I mean, this is something, once again, that one could read about in a novel. Leila Khaled landed the plane in Jordan and underwent plastic surgery to disguise herself. She eventually participated in the Black September hijackings that we discussed at the beginning of this session tonight. Remember there were five attempted hijackings, three were successful. Leila Khaled's attempted hijacking was unsuccessful. She was attempting to hijack the airliner with a Central American comrade. Her Central American comrade was killed during the attempt. And you need to ask yourselves, what is the significance of her actually trying to hijack this airliner on behalf of the Palestinian movement, Palestinian nationalism, with a Central American comrade? The real bottom line is that members of movements were talking to each other. They were helping each other. They were meeting together under similar causes, with a similar cause, and sort of had in their own minds a just cause on the world stage. So, for example, you would have European anarchists or European communists meeting with Latin American communists linking themselves with Palestinian nationalists on the world stage at that time. It was viewed as being part of a worldwide revolution, a worldwide movement that many people thought they were part of. There were people in the United States, for example, the Weather Underground, who viewed themselves as being part of the international revolution, that the world was about to embark upon a new era of revolutionary consciousness. So, she eventually, returned to Beirut. She was nearly assassinated by the Israelis, in a very dramatic manner, in which the Israelis essentially put Katyusha rockets in a building across the street from where she was living or where she was staying. They fired the rockets into the apartment building, nearly demolishing it, but Leila Khaled survived along with the leader of a Palestinian movement. She has written a book which is very widely read in the Middle East, especially among Palestinians, saying, "My people shall live." And she is now living in Amman, Jordan. She eventually married a physician, has lived a long life, and she is a former member of the Palestinian parliament. So Leila Khaled went on. Rather than being killed or assassinated or perhaps imprisoned, whatever it might be, she went on to live a long life as a stateswoman. Now, the question becomes, was Leila Khaled a terrorist? That's an open question that I'll leave with you. Because, as far as we know, she was not directly responsible for killing anyone. That, yes, she may have inspired people, and there are many posters of her with a rifle on her back. In fact, there was one that was in college dormitories during the 70s with a rifle on her back. But she was not like Carlos the Jackal, who was responsible for 83 deaths. She apparently was not responsible for any direct killings. So I'll leave you with that question. Yes, we can see how people become extremists. We can see how people become terrorists. But are all of these extremists who advocate violence terrorists? Or are they freedom fighters? That's an open question, because we can all identify with the oppressed of the world. Thank you very much. And we'll return next week to look at the topic of state terrorism, meaning terrorism by governments. So far, we've been talking about organizations and groups. We've been talking about individuals. But remember, governments have the ability to kill many more people, to terrorize many more people than these organizations do, because they have resources. They have armies. They have control over media and politics. So thank you very much. This is Gus Martin. I'll see you next time with Understanding Terrorism.